want to add my thanks to Shelby for that wonderful song. And I also want to thank Joel Pereira for providing the piano music this morning. Joel will bring the sermon next week. And so we'll see a little bit more of him. And I need to thank Sarah Iris Slusser. She put in tremendous work in organizing the Parents Night Out last night. And like anything new, we get a little hitch in our get along every once in a while. We get a few bumps and bruises when we start out. But it's a worthwhile ministry. And with her attitude and her zeal, it will be a great ministry. And we're all really encouraged by your efforts. Thank you so much. The book of Solomon lets us see that it was a time of distrust and disillusionment in the land of Israel. People did not trust those who governed them. Now that's odd. Those in positions of leadership were thought to be inept or corrupt, and often both. How odd that is. There was a lack of vision about the future of the people, because those in leadership seemed helpless, hopeless, and corrupt. Because of that fact, God looked outside the tents of the leadership and the power in order to find new vision. Now I should say that this is beginning to sound a little bit like a commentary on current American political life, but it is not. Even though you will find great similarities between today's politics and the life at the time of the book of Samuel, this is simply a sad tale. It's a tale of any nation, any family, any organization, any church which has lost its vision, which has lost its basic understanding of who it is and what it's about in the world. It is the story of any people who are living in the season of discontent. And it pushes them to ask, what is God doing in our world and in our lives? Because that's what we're always concerned with. What has God done? What is God doing? And what will God do? Those should be the three elements to almost every sermon that is ever preached. In the latter days of Eli, the priest, it was said that the nation of Israel, the word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. Sounds more and more like I'm talking about today. Eli was becoming old, but a dimness of eye and a dimness of mind were upon him, which were the product of more than simply old age. Eli, you see, was blind, but he was not blind in the physical sense. He was blind to the corruptness of his sons. And he was deaf to their cries for justice. And the vision of the Lord had departed from him. What does it mean to have lost your vision? for Eli and his sons, it meant that he had become blind and his sons had become corrupt. Now the sons of Eli were scoundrels, the scripture says. Well, what had they done? They had no regard for the Lord, for their duties, for what they were supposed to do. They took whatever they want, whatever didn't belong to them, demanding the best of everything, including whatever it was that belonged to the Lord. They engaged in scandalous, adulterous behavior. They treated God and the people with contempt. But we've heard it said, if you can do no good, then see if you can at least try to do no harm. Well, the sons of Eli did no good, and they also did much harm. They were lazy, they were greedy, and they were corrupt. As a result, community life was chaotic. It was violent, and religious life was extremely fractious and insecure. The people were waiting for a change, and they were becoming bitter and restless in their waiting time. Life was filled with violence, with brutality, with corruption, with ineffectiveness. Are we talking really about the 11th century before Christ? Or are we talking about the 21st century after Christ? It hasn't changed much, really, has it? You see, change did not come easily for the nation or the church. And it didn't come easily in ancient Israel. Yet the books of Samuel are the record of massive change taking place within people's lives and within the ability of people, much like us, to understand what it is that God wants. It's not as easy as saying, throw the rascals out. There is more to it than just politics. In the book of Samuel, the politics of need were confronted head on by God, by God's vision for the people in their life. So instead of strong, competent, mature leader, able to stand up to the sons of Eli and confront their corruption, bringing instant gratification to the needs of people, instead of the kind of super leader we always seem to be looking for, and must, to our astonishment, never seem to find, instead the word of the Lord came to a child. A child like Samuel. Pardon me. The word of the Lord came to that child who didn't even know whose voice it was that was calling him in the darkness of his sanctuary. The Lord called Samuel again a third time. And he got up and went and he said to Eli, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to the boy, Samuel, go lie down. And if he calls you, you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went down and lay in his place. And now the Lord came, and he was calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. You know, it's the usual thing to think in terms of what adults can teach children. Adults have much to teach children. They teach children ways to develop their bodies, their personalities, and certainly their relationships with God. But at the same time, children can often teach adults. What are some of the qualities that children and adults would do well to emulate from their children? Among these qualities are three prerequisites to entering the kingdom of God. These are the qualities which children can teach us adults. The children can teach adults the importance of the spirit of dependence. Children know that they do not get things done alone. They are dependent upon their parents or guardians for the gifts of life. Adults do well to remember that we do not get things done by ourselves, but we are dependent upon the supreme power of the universe for not only the gifts of life, but we're dependent for life itself. We need a childlike spirit of dependence. Dependence on God like a little child. Children also can teach us adults the importance of receptivity. A child is usually open to new and larger ideas, while we adults, more often than not, will try to stay with the devil we know rather than go with the angel we don't know. We don't like change. I often say that the only human being that likes change is a baby with a wet diaper. Adults do well to keep their minds open to new truths. During a period of history in Israel, when the prophetic vision was dim and the priesthood had fallen into dispute, the Lord spoke to this boy, Samuel. And when the child heard the call of God, he replied, "Speak, for thy servant hears." Adults do well to say that to God. "Speak, for thy servant hears." Children can teach adults the importance of a spirit of enthusiasm. When a child is faced with a challenge, he or she usually tackles it enthusiastically. So adults do well, when we hear the voice of God, to act spontaneously. The Master appreciated all of those who acted spontaneously. He chose for his disciples and among his closest friends those who acted in that manner. Think of John the Baptist, Andrew and Simon, the woman of the city who wet his feet with tears and wiped them with hair and kissed them with her lips and anointed his feet with ointment. He showed appreciation for all of these when he told them, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." When Peter cried out in that one moment of impulse, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God," Jesus replied, "Bless you, Simon Bar-Jonah." As the Christ loved those who responded to him spontaneously with childlike faith, so he loves those today but do not calculate the cost of being a Christian, but take him gladly as the Lord of their lives. When you think of what a child can teach an adult, and it is no wonder that God chose Samuel, a child, to hear and speak the great word which would make all the ears of the world tingle, as it says in Samuel 3:11. The child was certainly an outsider in politics of Israel. But what could a child do after all? What could a child bring to that tangled web of deceit and corruption which was strangling Israel? How effective could a child be? How could a child address the great issues of the day? To say with the prophet Isaiah, a little child shall lead them, is really fine during the sweet sentimentality of the Christmas season, when you're feeling nostalgic for simpler times. It seems weak and foolish and harsh in the light of summertime politics. One day, Jesus heard his disciples trying to prevent parents from bringing their children to see him and touch him. And he became angry with his disciples, and he said, "Let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for such belong to the kingdom of God." Jesus is not talking about these little children. Friends, he's talking about their parents. Don't stop those children, my children, from coming to me. Bring them to me. And in that passage, he tells you and I that we are children of God. And to be children means to learn and to know and to accept. And sometimes we hear this story and we think it's only learning from it that we get. It's a God love little children, and therefore we should love little children as well. Well, that's one of the messages. But there is a deeper meaning. A deeper meaning for you and for me, which is that Jesus means a lot more when he says that. Remember, he says, "Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." He's telling you, he's telling me to be like a child. If you want to enter the kingdom of God, if you want to be a part of God's vision, God's future, God's hope for the world and for eternity, come to God like a child like Samuel. It is easy to get sentimental about children, especially about infants, and to talk about their innocence and their purity. Yet any parent who has walked the floor through a long night with a swallowing infant that won't go to sleep will understand the tyranny and the dependence of a child. In fact, it seems to me that the most dominant characteristic of any young child is that child's total dependence on you for all its needs, for everything, for food, for warmth, for shelter, for cleanliness, even in the earliest infancy, for mobility. Totally, helplessly dependent. That, my friends, describes us and the kingdom of God. Totally, helplessly dependent. Why did God choose Samuel? Why did God call Samuel? Possibly because in calling Samuel, God's new vision for the people of Israel was being given to the one who, like any child, was totally dependent upon God. Samuel did not even know how to use his own words. Yet in dependence and trust, he could say, "Here I am. I am listening." Let us conclude this message today on, as we celebrate the Day of the Child, by saying that we know and recognize that it is our proper function and it is our duty in life to teach our children. Otherwise, however else would they learn? But consider this. Is it not also our function and our duty to learn from our children? What can we learn in these times when the word of the Lord is rare and visions are not widespread? Perhaps we can learn that it is a good thing to be dependent as a child. To live a life of trust in God. For such is the kingdom of God. And that would not be a bad thing for folks like us who are fiercely independent and individualistic as we are to learn. Then perhaps, just perhaps, like the child Samuel, we too could hear God's word and catch God's vision before it passes by and we become even more like the sons of Eli. Amen.